My guest today is the Honorable Joseph DiAguardi, who represented Westchester County in the House of Representatives in the middle 1980s. And because today is April 15th, as we all know, is known to Americans as Tax Day, our subject is the viability of the American financial system and can we afford to continue on America's current path of tax and spend and survive economically. Joe, you testified in Washington in February about the future fiscal sustainability of the United States government. Give our audience an update of what you talked about.
I was honored to be called to testify because the group that I got in front of to testify is called the Federal Accounting Standards Advisory Board, FASAB. And coincidentally, it was a bill that I passed, that I introduced, that was finally passed and signed by President Bush a year after I left the Congress, for a chief financial officer, which included the requirement that we would need a new way to promulgate generally accepted accounting principles for the federal government. Mm. We already had it for the private sector through the Securities and Exchange Commission. And I saw this need because I came out of the accounting profession and I had this kind of experience which allowed me to make some good innovative suggestions. So here I am now going all these years later in front of that board. And the reason for it is that they publish every year a statement called the Consolidated Financial Statements of the United States of America. And this is a 110-page book. Well, I went with my wife, Shirley, a day early to Washington just so I could go through that and understand the financial makeup of the United States of America.
Was it understandable?
Well, it's not quite. In fact, if you saw my testimony, you would say, I told this board, you need a new format because you have too many constituencies. You just can't put 110 pages and say you reported to America. You've got politicians. You've got academics, actuaries, accountants. And I said, where's the people? They can't read this. And the fact that you put it on a website is not going to make them understand what's going on. In fact, you should have one or two pages just for the people. Send it out with their tax return forms. Say, hey, we need your taxes this year, but here's how we spent it last year, and use the right accounting system. Now, what was this all about? They figured that with the increasing debt in America, they needed to come up with a new statement on fiscal sustainability that they would add to this already large book. And the reason for it is that if you look at 10 or 20 years from now, and just take what Obama has told us, that he expects to add $10 trillion to the national debt. And by the way, his national debt is what's on the books, the Treasury bonds and bills. Does not include the $53 trillion that's a liability for Social Security and Medicare, but stick with what's on the books. He's now going to borrow in the next 10 years another $10 trillion. Add that to the $10 trillion that's on the books. Hey, you got to look at the interest. We had a 22% prime rate under Jimmy Carter. Why? Inflation drove it up. That could happen again. But right now, interest rates are low. But God forbid they go high and we got $20 trillion plus. This interest expense alone will push out other money from other government programs.
So you're basically saying whatever Dirksen said, now you're talking about real money. That's what you're talking about. Now the question
is, we used to talk about billions. Now we're up to trillions.
Now we have a situation, of course, where Obama is proposing, as you mentioned, this huge amount of spending. Let us hope that the GDP grows
yes,
to be able to finance it. Wouldn't you say, and I know we're going to get into this because we're spending a lot of time on this, wouldn't you say that the greatest threat in terms of the entitlement area is a large baby boom generation,
sure,
that when the youngest baby boomers are 66, the oldest will be 84 years old, and that group will be the largest living group in history. In other words, more people will be alive in that large, wealthy group, and the group behind it is smaller and poorer.
Right.
Now, that's more of a threat to me than the spending now, because if the economy brings back, look how well the banks are doing. The banks are already ready to pay back part of the TARP. So we feel if the country can become profitable, and that's a big if, we can amortize the debt. If we don't amortize the debt, then we're, as every accountant knows, we're in a business will roll over in 2 seconds.
The key word is not profitable, it's productivity.
Productivity.
The thing that has saved this country in the last 20, 30 years, because we've had the deficits, we've had the waste, but we have managed to keep the technological edge. The companies like Microsoft, IBM, Oracle, you name it, Google, they've turned two people into three, four, and five. When you have the tools, then you can compete worldwide. Now, it's funny you should mention that, and I want to get back to your other point, but one of the things that I had to mention in my testimony was this. Are we putting out information to see how much of our GDP we're spending on defense? Because a lot of what we spend on defense doesn't come back here. We don't expect to get paid back by Iraq. So we need to see the trend line. And in this statement on fiscal sustainability, one of the things we should be measuring every year is what is the percentage that the U.S. is spending on defense compared to the other, let's say, G20? And what's that trend? Because if we are not going to become, what's the key word now? Competitive. How can we divert that much money to something and then it could ruin our competitiveness? The other thing, Richard, is R&D. One of the trick bags now is they want to reduce certain things. And one of the things that's on the table is to reduce the expenses for R&D through the military and non-military. But it was R&D that made this country strong with technology.
Let me get into a couple of things. And I just want, since you brought up this point, remember, the United States defense spending is equal to all the other defense spending in the world, as our jails have more people than all the countries of the world except China. They just shoot people.
Everything should be on the table right now. Energy reform, healthcare reform, entitlement. You mentioned entitlements. You're absolutely right. There's a tsunami coming. These baby boomers. And guess what we did? We raised Social Security rates and the base from 1983 to save Social Security. But what did they do with the money? It didn't go into a trust fund. They used it on everything else.
$2 trillion is owed by the federal government, and they don't have it.
Right.
But I'd worry more about Medicare and Medicaid with these older people because, you know, you can tweak Social Security. You know that. You can tweak it. You can actuarially look at it.
You can extend
a percentage.
Right.
You pay it up to $120,000 instead of $92,000.
Right.
It can be done. Medicare and Medicaid, who people in the last 2 or 3 years of their lives are using incredible expensive, that's much more
of a... Take the drug program alone. When that was passed, they gamed the system. They said it was only going to cost us $400 million. The latest tag on that, there's only a few years since it's been passed, is already we're up to $7 trillion just in the liability, if we had to put it on the books that we have right now for those alive on that program.
Yeah, that's much more of a problem. I have your book, of course, Unaccountable Congress, right in front of me. A great many things have changed since 1992 when you published it. Is your book valid today?
It is more valid today because if you see the cover of the book, what did I put on it?
I put a
version of a congressman's voting card, which is the same size as a credit card. It's a plastic card congressmen use and congresswomen at the end of a row of seats is a computer terminal. You put it in. A yellow light goes up by your name if you're present, a green light if you say yes, a red light no. And I realized, Richard, when I was putting that card in, that every time I put it in, since we had deficits during the Reagan administration, that's why we had Graham
Rudman. The largest since World War II.
Right. And then we started to increase the national debt. So I said, you know what? This is the most expensive credit card in the world. So I put it on the cover of the book, Credit Line Unlimited. Expiration date, never. Built to future generations.
That's for sure.
Now, aren't we doing that today? This is 1992, and I was forecasting...
Nothing has changed.
...that we could become insolvent.
But it's interesting.
There's another problem.
Yeah, go ahead.
You talk about being a hostage. You mentioned oil. Hey, we've got $2 trillion we're borrowing from China and Japan, mainly from China. And guess what? We need more money from China.
This
is not the way to build a strong America.
These are intractable problems that the Tea Parties won't solve. Let's face it.
Exactly.
You know, it's interesting. You talk of a budgetary process gone wild. We see the lack of control by both parties regarding spending. And with that in mind, why is the federal budget process so flawed? And could you explain why you have written and said that Congress should change its processes?
Right.
Why is this? Why is it so flawed?
It's human nature. When you're a politician, you want to look good on your watch so that you are reelected. Okay?
Right.
Now, where did this all start, the funny business with the budget process? It really started with a Democrat, Lyndon Baines Johnson.
That's correct.
Who came up with the unified budget because he saw the surpluses in the trust funds. Social Security, Highway Trust Fund. And he said, you know what? I can disguise the real cost of the Vietnam War by now netting the surpluses against the deficits, and they come up with a lower deficit number.
That was actually a balanced budget because of that 1969. So, that was the last one.
But it wasn't a real balanced budget because they took cash they shouldn't have taken. That money should have been set aside, the trust funds, and not used against current expenditures. But then the Republicans came in. They had deficits. What did they do? We have Graham Rudman. I came in 1985. What was Graham Rudman? It was a 4-year plan to take the deficit down to zero. They never made it. By the end of 1990, it wasn't working. They got rid of it. Then they came up with the Budget Enforcement Act. All right, if we're going to spend something, that means we got to either raise taxes or reduce spending someplace else. That lasted for a couple of years. They got rid of every Congress seems to have its own idea on what the budget process should be. What's the answer? Take numbers and the budget process away from politicians. We need a separate agency like the Fed on monetary policy for the fiscal policy.
With the sins of Bernard Madoff still in the news, you mention in your book, and this is a long time ago when you wrote it, that Social Security is a Ponzi scheme. What does that really mean, Joe?
Well, if you look at the title I gave to Chapter 5 in my book, it's Congressional Child Abuse, Send the Kids the Bill. And this is what we're doing. It's an extension of the comment I made before when we talked about the baby boomers. When we bailed out or tried to bail out the impending bankruptcy of Social Security back in 83, there was a commission put together. They raised the rate and the base. Everybody who has a job knows that FICA taxes went up.
Right.
Now, we were supposed to put that aside because we knew that the amount of people working in the future would not be as much as the ones working in the past relative to those retiring. And that's what's coming up now, because the baby boomers who were working and contributing their FICA taxes are now coming into the system in the next 5 years, and they want their benefits.
Right.
Okay?
That's a large group.
And they paid a lot into Social Security. And relative to in the last 50 years, they've paid the most. But that money's not there because we literally used it to reduce the deficits in other programs. So, in effect, what we've done is we've taken from one generation and we've given to the other. This is the generation who earned it, who put the money into the system, but it's not there for them. So now what we have to do is raise taxes on the next generation to replace that money. And that's going to be a big burden for the next generation when they need capital to compete. But now they got to make up for our overspending in the past. So I saw this as kind of a Ponzi scheme because it's intergenerational inequity.
But
you
Joe,
can't do that.
Joe, the $2 trillion that is owed Social Security, it's on the books as $2 trillion. The $2 trillion was added to the general
budget.
It's more
than $2 trillion. When you put the other trust funds, you're talking about almost $4
trillion. All right,
in Treasury bills, in private accounts. These are not held by the public. They're held in accounts that the government has, and they accrue interest.
Right. Now, but that
but
money,
the cash isn't there.
Those trillions, those trillions were spent in the general budget.
Done.
And the rationale was that there's two rationales to this, that if we didn't spend it, put it in the general budget, we would have had raised taxes on that end. So we understand they didn't want to raise any more taxes on that or have been a larger deficit on end. The $2 trillion actually is another part of the deficit.
In other words,
it's not really $11 trillion. It's really $13, $14, or $15.
Absolutely.
Now, on the other hand, when you discuss this about it, you never finish the coffee and the cake at the same time. If that money would have been sitting in the trust fund,
right. You
know the pressure would have been to lower the FICA withholding from 7.08 to 7. In other words, to reduce that.
Well,
you know that. And the truth is that they were caught in a quandary on that. But look, let's go on
But basic accounting says this.
Right.
Let me bring it home to people who belong to, let's say, a club or a society where they prepay their dues. When you prepay your dues, they don't put that right into income. That has to be put in what they call a deferred income account, which is really a liability, until the months go by and then they bring it in to match the income against the expenses.
Right.
Well, that's basically what they should have done with Social Security.
It's too sensible, Joe.
Yeah, well, but this is generally accepted accounting principles.
Right.
Why should the government be exempt from the rules it imposes through the Securities and Exchange Commission on publicly traded companies? We only want to protect shareholders. Let's protect the taxpayers.
Joe, let me tell you something. I wish, and this is no slight on you because you left it a long time ago. I wish Arthur Andersen with WorldCom and Enron had general accounting principles. Where does the guilt not fall?
But don't forget, with Arthur Andersen, that was political hubris, prosecutorial hubris, not to go after three partners in Houston who were responsible for Enron, but young prosecutors now take a whole firm with 50,000 employees and indict it. And then what happened? Anderson took it to the Supreme Court and won 9-0, but the firm's reputation was damaged. It was gone.
Right.
This is not good social policy. Now you've contracted 8 big firms down to 4, and one of them was Arthur Anderson.
Right. You know, most people realize that Medicare and Medicaid is much less predictable than Social Security. And we've discussed this huge Social Security, what's owed to it. What is the real liability for Social Security and Medicare? Are they the same? Is it true that the next generation benefits may have to be compromised?
No question about it. Medicare now outweighs Social Security by tens of millions of dollars.
Tens of billions, excuse me.
This is now, we're getting
Everett
back to
Dirksen,
that.
You know.
Yes. Actually, it's really tens of trillions now.
Probably trillions.
Because the number, and the number is advertised, you know, Pete Peterson made $5 billion on Blackwatch. I think it was... BlackRock. One of those.
BlackRock. One of those blacks.
He took $1 billion and put it in the Pete Peterson Foundation, and he hired away one of the most independent people in government, the Comptroller General. He was a partner of mine at Anderson, David Walker. So we know he's doing well. So the first thing they did is they took a 2-page ad out in the Times, Centerfold. Now, that has to cost at least $100,000.
Right.
And they're saying, what's wrong with the books of America? The first thing that they said was that the current liability for Social Security and Medicare, if put on the actuarial basis, the way a corporation has to do it for its audits and books, is $53 trillion.
That's right.
That is nowhere on the books of the United States right now. Who's going to pay for this? Obviously, we're hoping in the future that we're going to somehow raise the money or become that productive. But really, what do we need? We need a whole entitlement reform commission now to start thinking ahead. We can't wait until it happens. We got to start preparing for it.
Joe, the mindset of America is pretty funny. 9/11 came. Everybody was patriotic. Everybody knew something had to be done. I'm not going to go into the politics of Afghanistan first, always and ever, and Iraq. I'm not going to go into that. But it's interesting. If the government would have gone to the public and asked for a defined tax to pay for that war and maybe even Iraq, when it was justified, right or wrong, the people would have gone along with it. Is that correct or not?
There's no question that Americans are willing to sacrifice, as they did in World War II, once they know what the plan is and once they know that it's being shared fairly. The problem with taxation is people don't trust it anymore because they think some people are getting away with it, like the corporations with the offshore tax havens, which now is becoming a big deal.
Cayman Islands, Bahamas.
And if you don't trust your tax system, and don't forget, we're on a self-assessment system. We prepare our returns. Now, most of it's collected through the withholding payroll. But the point is, we still have a self-assessment system. And for it to work, people have to trust that it's being administered fairly. And a lot of them don't trust it.
But frankly, if the president would have come to the public and said, we have to pay for this, no more, we can't have guns and butter.
Right.
Roosevelt said that in 1941. He took the 42, he took the Dr. New Deal hat off, put on Dr. Win the War. How about this in Somalia? Millions for defense, but not a penny towards tribute. I was told the other day it's cheaper for these companies to pay the pirates than to have it.
Which is ridiculous. There'll be more pirates.
Of course. We fought the Barbary Coast War. Undeclared war with France, Sea War, 1797. War of 1812 and First World War over freedom of the seas. Right. All of a sudden, we have to spend the money to have freedom of the seas. But where is it, Joe? In other words, it comes down to leadership.
It comes down to people being informed. What did Thomas Jefferson say? Thomas Jefferson said the currency of democracy is information.
Right.
If you're not informed, the people are not able to inject themselves. We need more citizens' participation in government. We need more Thomas Paines. We're sitting here in New Rochelle, and I remember when I announced for Congress, I did it at his cottage here.
You know, with this in mind, and as bring back on course here, we have this large baby boom generation that's living longer and longer. Thank God we're living longer and longer. The impact on the following generation, which is smaller and smaller and poor, could be critical. Can America go into default like New York City almost did in 1975? We got a big agenda, Joe, so we're going to go quick.
Let me give you the numbers.
Sure.
The answer is yes.
Okay.
Unless we prepare, become productive again, and limit consumption. We've been on a consumption binge now for 20, 30 years, and Americans have to begin to start saving. They had a zero savings rate until this recession. Now people are nervous, so they're starting to save money. We're up to 5%, 4%, which is hurting us because we want to see them spend.
Right.
But we need a balance there. But let me give you the numbers. The mortgage debt today is six times the GDP of America. It's somewhere between $60 and $70 trillion. I just gave you a number, $53 trillion for Social Security and Medicare, and that doesn't include all these other liabilities that are off the books because we have a lousy accounting system. So student loans and farm loans, we don't take an allowance for bad debts. We wait till there's, like, the savings and loan crisis, a default, and then we say, where's the money?
So we're all...
And then you have consumer debt is up to $1 trillion. Now, how are you going to service all this debt? And since we're already dependent upon China, don't you see the possibility, Richard, that we could be... And sometime in the future, if we don't manage this properly, where New York City was in 1975, when they literally needed the United States of America to bail them out. Remember Big Mac, Field Sure. Royton? Hey, it could happen.
Yeah, in other words,
you said we may have to default then on some of these entitlements.
You know, speaking of supporting our debt, and of course you articulate your views on the Treasury Department in the book. Is the U.S. Treasury Department subject to SEC rules and regulation when it sells or issues Treasury bills, notes, or bonds, and does it matter?
Absolutely not. The government, and there's another chapter in my book where I list every law that the federal government passed and exempted themselves from it, including OSHA, including, you know, employees' safety and things like that. Now, the people should know this and write their representatives and say, hey, if you're going to impose rules on us, we want to see those same rules imposed on you. Mm-hmm. And if you're now going to protect shareholders through the Securities and Exchange Commission, why aren't you using the same accounting principles and audits and governance like Sarbanes-Oxley in the federal government, especially on these GSEs, government-sponsored enterprises? What are they? Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, the Post Office, the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation, the Farm Credit. There are 29 of them that are not on the budget.
You know,
they're like these authorities that Brodsky's talking about. These are like slush funds for the politicians to put their friends on for big salaries. And in the last 3 years, what do? They get a nice big pension based on that big salary. Hey, stop gaming. You know, we've had enough gaming of the system on Wall Street. Now the politicians are gaming the system, but they're hiding what they're doing, so only people like me, a CPA, can pick it up.
You know, Joe, as we mentioned off mic, foreign nations, some friendly and not so friendly, are supporting our national debt with financial paper. What is, in regards to this huge national debt and how much is owed to people like China, how dangerous is this?
Well, let me give you an example. Hillary Clinton went to China recently. Has there ever been a time where we went to China at that level and didn't mention Tiananmen Square or something to do with human rights with Tibet? You didn't hear a peep out of her on Tibet. If Lantos was alive, my good friend,
Tom Lantos,
who helped me with the Albanian thing, he would be writing her a letter the next day. Why? They're afraid now that China might reconsider not lending us the money we need right now.
She was coming with cap in hand. That's yes. What you're saying. What does the unified budget mean, Joe? And okay. Is this a sound way to calculate our annual budget deficit?
Absolutely not. It was a figment, a political trick back in the late 60s to disguise, as I said, the cost of the Vietnam War. And it basically took these trust funds that had surpluses and said, all right, we got surpluses here. Why not meld the cash there against the deficits in the other accounts so we come up with a net deficit? We should be showing this stuff gross. Mm-hmm. We should have left that there. Now, people would say, well, Joe, you can't leave that money sitting there. It's got to be invested someplace. Sure, let the Treasury borrow it like it's doing right now, but show it as part of the national debt. Don't disguise it by saying that now the deficit is in half when you know it's not in half because you took advantage of money that should have been set aside for the future.
In other words, what we're finding, and on both sides of the aisle, is a lack of candidness, a lack of practicality, a lack of looking forward. Back to what you said earlier, passing it on to Junior somewhere in the future. Of course, right. The truth is that I hope there is a future in this sense, you know. Getting more current in a sense, and we know this problem has been going on for decades. The catalyst to the market's recent meltdown and ensuing credit crunch has been attributed to two factors: toxic mortgages and the mm-hmm. bundling and reselling of debt instruments called derivatives. How would you have solved the mortgage debt crisis when we first heard about the real problem last fall?
You could do a show just on this. As soon as I heard the problem, this was last fall, I wrote a letter to the New York Times, which they didn't publish. And it was a simple thing to me. Now, obviously, people who were given mortgages and they didn't have a job, they don't have income, that was wrong. There's no way to save those people.
Right.
The banks probably have to come in and do something. But many of the people were tricked into high-interest mortgages by the teaser loans now, right. And it's going up. As it goes up, the income can't sustain it. Now, those people, the bank has to work out something. But in the meantime, take what they can pay.
Right.
Don't take them out of the houses.
Right.
Keep them in the houses at all costs. If they can't afford it, take what they can pay. Now, what do you do with that difference? You add it to the back of the mortgage, and you let the government guarantee that. The value is going to go back up, maybe not in 5 years, but 10 and 15.
Right.
So a part of that equity belongs to the bank. If the bank doesn't get it, it was a guarantee by the federal government. That would be the cheapest way to do it.
You know,
so
no,
sensical.
And you
common
know,
sense.
And you know no 30-year mortgages are ever paid in most cases. So if it's on the back end,
yeah.
Look, who...
But when they sell the house,
most people shouldn't even take a 30-year mortgage.
Right, but when they sell the house,
right.
The mortgage has
right.
to be paid,
exactly.
including this piece that is, you know,
right.
the bank still owned because it wasn't paid up front.
No
so
question.
Add it to the back. I had a similar thing with the banks. Why did they create a toxic bank now? This, to me, is nonsense. They should have allowed the banks that have these things on the books to work it out. They know who they lent to, or at least they think they know because they did slice and dice. But let the banks... get an advance from the federal government, let's say 50%. Now you know it's worth at least 50. It's going to cost us 50 anyway, the way
right.
they're doing it. But now by interjecting the investment bankers as part of this and giving them the leverage 6-to-1, we're now going back to the people who created the problem.
Well,
how do we know they're going to solve this problem?
Right. What about this bundling of derivatives, which had no equity, which
Forget
was...
It.
I mean, is this...
It's a sin.
Is this the highest part of irresponsibility?
It's the height of fraud... and stupidity on our part that we didn't see it coming, because basically what a credit default swap is a fancy name for an insurance contract. But if you use the word insurance, then you're subject to the insurance commissioners of every state, which means you got to set aside something in a reserve. They didn't want to do that, so they called it everything but insurance. They keep writing this paper so everybody can make huge commissions, like that unit of AIG that was in London. They made $1 million a day, these employees.
Right. Let's talk about that.
And now we have to bail this out.
Right. You know, recently a great deal about awarding bonuses to executives of bankrupt companies on government life support. Also been talk about out-of-control executive compensation by friendly corporate boards. AIG is not only on life support, but why was AIG not allowed to fail anyway? And what was the credit? And what... why did they get involved so deeply in an insurance company and this credit default swaps?
It was another way to increase earnings per share now. This is the name of the game. We're all thinking short term. The stock market was the answer. How can I drive the stock up? Because I have options.
Options.
I'm one of the guys. So all of a sudden, it's earnings per share. Even a penny made a difference. We got to get away from that and start thinking long term again. AIG, too big to fail. Why? We still don't know how many trillions on both sides they wrote. I mean, they're counterparties here. And
right.
by the way, Paulson has something to answer, because the first ones he bailed out were his friends on Wall Street by giving them 100% on the other side of the AIG things last fall.
Right. You know, the current deficits are incredibly large. The future deficits seem daunting. Many believe that only high taxes on the wealthy, the repeal of the Bush inheritance tax, in other words, throw grandma from the train law, and other revenue enhancements are badly needed but are politically dangerous. Mm-hmm. With all that in mind, do you... How are this expensive machine, which is America, going to be paid? Who's going to pay the bills on this? I got. Give me 30 seconds because we want to leave 30 seconds.
Okay.
I got a minute left.
You want me to answer that now?
30 seconds.
Okay. Who's going to pay? We have to go back to work in America. It's a shared responsibility. What did we do in World War II when we had a problem? Everybody said, let me know what you want me to do. Americans have to hear from the president. He's a good guy with the bully pulpit, as you know.
Right.
This is our problem. Here's what we need everybody to do, and everybody's got to share in it. We got to go back to work. We got to start saving a little bit, and we got to stop becoming more productive than we were, and we can't have all these trade deficits with other countries. We can't become protectionist, but we can't overconsume either.
And we can't be an economy based on profligate spending.
Absolutely.
We're running out of time. I want to thank my guests. It's been a fantastic hour. It goes so quickly.
But mention the website, because if they want a copy of the
ahead.
Book.
Go ahead. Give me the website.
Just look at truthingovernment.org. Just spell out as one word, truthingovernment.org. Download the book. You'll see my recent speeches. You'll even see my video from my testimony.
I got to say goodbye. I want to just congratulate Joe on his daughter being on American Idol.
That little girl raised here in New Rochelle, Wilmot Woods.